pronounce that correctly. He's a former fire chief of Burns, Oregon. He's one of the good guys. He was sickened by what he experienced and witnessed there, and he was one of the ones that exposed the FBI undercover agents.
Yeah.
A big round of applause.
My name is Chris Bryles. I moved to Harney County, Oregon in 1978 from Colorado because I didn't like the big city, Denver, and everybody seemed like they were in a big hurry to die. I mean, rushing everywhere, doing everything. I moved out to Harney County because I thought, here's a place I can raise my children. Here's a place that doesn't have corruption and crime. They had drugs like everybody else does. But I thought, this is a cool place. I moved there. The mill, Edward Hines Lumber Mill, was running. Had over 600 employees, running day in, day out, 24 hours a day. You know, they were cutting 1 million board feet of timber per day in the mill. That's a tremendous amount of resource. There were Jippo loggers, independent loggers, there were logging outfits, they were doing all kinds of stuff. And when I moved there, if they had a forest fire, guess what happened? As soon as there was a smoke anywhere, the loggers threw their stuff down and they aggressively attacked it. And as soon as the rancher heard that there was a fire up there where their cattle grazed in the summer, they got their butts up there. All our buckaroos, everybody. If it was a bad fire, they shut the mill down and all the employees went up and they fought it and they put it out. We had no big fires, none. And gradually I noticed that you would hear, well, they had a fire up on Buck Creek and old Bill was up there, he was going by with his cat and he stopped and he was gonna put a fire line around and the Forest Service came by and said, no. Too much liability. We have to wait till one of our contract cats gets up here in the next couple, 3-4 hours, maybe 2 or 3 days. And a 20-minute job would have taken care of it, but they wait. And they wait. The ranchers weren't allowed to fight their own fire on their own grazing allotments. People weren't allowed to go up there and even look at the fire. You know, you guys get back, you're gonna get hurt, you know. This is a dangerous job. Well, it is dangerous, but they weren't getting hurt because they weren't really doing anything. So I saw it transition and go that way. I saw the people come in as, oh gosh, you can't cut trees, you know. They had the spotted owl over on the coast and all of that stuff. Did you ever see an owl that didn't fly? You know, it can fly to a different tree. You know, they used to, yeah, weird concept, but they used to have all kinds of strange stuff going on, you know, and it's not just in Harney County. I hear the same thing that went on here, you know. You had a tortoise that now's a pain in the neck, you know. Go figure. How does that work? How does that work? You know, and it's just been going on. It's getting worse and worse and worse. We had the Hammonds. A lot of you people have heard about the Hammonds, Dwight and Stephen Hammond. When I was a county fire chief for 32 years, Steve Hammond was probably the most cooperative of all the ranchers. He would call me and he'd say, "Hey, Chris, I gotta do a little bit of burn. What do you want me to do?" Well, okay, let's talk it over. Yeah, okay, yeah, go for it. And the Hammonds Ranch was surrounded by BLM managed land. That's public land, people. BLM doesn't own anything. They're not supposed to own anything. Ask them and they'll tell you, oh yeah, that's ours. But it's not. It's ours. they were trying to run the Hammonds off their ranch, you know, and it started with water. The same kind of thing that happened to these folks right here. There was a water right, and the Hammonds filed on it. If you're going to have a right, you have to file on it, you have to use it, you have to protect it, you know, own it. Well, they filed on some water rights. And then the refuge says, oh, no, we want that water. And the Hammond said, no, we filed on it, it's ours. And so they developed the water, and so the BLM came in, and they fenced around the water features so that the cattle couldn't get them. You know, is that just a tad underhanded?
Yeah.
And it just went from one thing to another, to another, to another, to another. And I'm sure that the Hammonds made a mistake now and again just by being too upset over it. But what would you do? What would you do if they were trying to run you out of business? They didn't do anything other than one of the fires that was lit, the BLM lit a fire, and it was headed towards the Hammond Ranch. They set a backfire. And it got off of their property, and they burned less than 140 acres of ground. Less than 140 acres of ground, and they put it out, and no one got hurt. $400,000 fine and 5 years in prison. And the judge said this would shock the conscience for the minimum, the mandatory minimum sentence was 5 years because it was under the Terrorism Act. And so the judge said this would shock the conscience to give someone 5 years for this. So he gave them significantly less sentences. They both went and served their sentences. They looked forward to getting out. They got out. They came home. And the federal government said, wait a minute, you didn't do all your sentence. So they took them back and made them, they're still in prison, serving out that sentence.
Double jeopardy.
And very, very little of it was done correctly. It was just done. Because that's the way it works. I saw the same kind of a thing in the trial for the Bundys over in Portland. Corrupt courts. Corrupt courts for the Hammonds. It's ridiculous. It's absolutely, totally ridiculous. When I had heard about the Bundys, and I watched on the TV, and I thought, wow, they're made out to be a bunch of radicals, and they look like ranchers. But these are radical ranchers. And I watched that, and I watched the helicopters and all of that kind of crap, and then all of a sudden, the BLM packed their little toys and went home. And I went, what's wrong with that? What's wrong with that? Ruby Ridge and all that other stuff, that ain't how it worked. Typically, they go in and they annihilate everybody, and they say, that's the way it goes, and that we were well justified and all of that. The BLM left the Bundys. Why? Because they were in the wrong. That's the only thing that my mind could wrap around is they were in the wrong. And they knew it. And they had to get out of there. So they left with their tail between their legs and a big vendetta to have. Well, Ammon, Ryan, all these guys, they heard about the Hammonds in Harney County. They came to help. As soon as they came to help, the BLM, the federal government, they told the Hammonds, if you talk with these people, if you have anything at all to do with them, we're going to make things way, way worse on you. But the Bundys, they were still there. They came to help. I heard they were going to be speaking at our fairgrounds. And so I thought, well, nobody tells me what to think about you or you or you. I'm going to come and I'm going to shake your hand. I'm going to look you right square in the eye. I'm going to make up my own mind. I'm not listening to the news media because they don't really do well with the truth. You know,
God intervened.
It's It's scary. I've been interviewed lots of times and then look and see what was said, and it certainly wasn't something I said. And it just keeps going on. They asked me to come and talk, but I don't have enough time to talk about all of it that went on. You know, I saw our little town, our happy little town, and all of a sudden, the Bundys, they came. We went on a peaceful walk. We sang songs and gave flowers to the Hammonds. And then Ammon went out and occupied the refuge. I didn't know anything about what the refuge occupation was about. I was pretty slow in the head. I had just been nominated to the Committee of Safety. Ammon, Ryan, and those guys had talked to us about the Committee of Safety and the importance of it in our history. And I was at that meeting. He says, "Do you think we should have a Committee of Safety?" Everybody, it was unanimous, yes. "Let's open it up for nominations." First guy got nominated, now look what happened to him. I was the second one. And he bailed out right after that. So I didn't know what I was supposed to do. I wish I would have. At that time, I wish I would have. We needed to take a redress of grievances. I don't know if you've heard of that, but it's something that you can do. You say, "Hey, government, you're doing things a little bit wrong here. We'd like to relook at this Hammond case. Let's look and see if there were errors made. And if there was something wrong or broken, let's fix it and make it right." They wouldn't have anything at all to do with it. They ignored it. They wouldn't pay any attention to us. If I would have known a little more about the Committee of Safeties, we could have done a little bit more. But the other problem that we had with our Committee of Safety is we had some people that said, "I'm not signing anything. My God, I don't know what they're going to do to us.
No.
You know, I've got a business, and if I sign that thing, man, the county's going to come down on me, and I ain't going to have a..." You know, and I looked at it, and I thought, well, what's right and what's wrong? We all know the difference between right and wrong. It don't make a bit of difference on who's going to intimidate you. If it's right, it's right. If it's wrong, it's wrong. So I stood up for what I felt was right. And we had a little dinky town. Harney County is a little over 10,500 square miles, and there's 7,000 people that live in it. And 3,000 of them live in Burns, and 2,000 live in Hines, and then the rest of them are scattered way out. Peaceful little community, everybody waves, "Hi, how you doing?" Stop and help everybody. I always did. I grew up on a ranch, that's what you do. If you see somebody that needs help, you stop and help them. If they don't need help, they'll tell you, "I don't need any help, thank you." And you made them smile. What's wrong with that? You know, but they came in, and here all of a sudden, we've got MREPs. Military vehicles, we got Black Hawk helicopters, we've got police agencies from all over the place, we have the FBI, we've got the military. They put chain link fences around our courthouse and our junior high and put snipers up on top of those buildings because the Bundys were there, and they were out there 30 miles away at the refuge, and they had guns. And I was out there a lot of times, and I saw a lot of guns, and I never, ever, ever did I see one that I thought would have reached 30 miles back in the town. Ever. It's just ridiculous. It's absolutely ridiculous. They were throwing ranchers down on the ground in the snow that were just going to feed their cattle. Exit the vehicle, throw them on the ground. Just be tough guys. And intimidate people and scare people. And they were in town in Burns and Hines, and there were all these black SUVs with the blacked out windows going around. All of these reports about, oh, they were harassing the local law enforcement officers and doing this and doing that and doing this and doing that. And it was all the Patriots that were doing that. Well, there was, you know, the three percenters, the oath keepers were there. There were quite a lot of people. I've been in Harney County since 1978, and as county fire chief and as the Burns fire chief, and I ran the ambulance. So I've been all over that county, and I know a lot of people. And I don't own anything other than my house, but in my heart and in my soul, these are my people. This is my country. What are you doing in my country? What the heck is going on? You know, and our local judge had his county court meetings at the high school. They parade around there in his little peacock shirt and be a big shot. You know, it was ridiculous. People were afraid. People wouldn't talk to each other anymore. Families were breaking up. Friends weren't talking to each other. Oh, I'm on this side. I'm on that side. And there was somebody stirring the pot everywhere you went. And that's a ploy that they do. They've done it in war all over the world. You divide and you conquer. You divide and you conquer. So here they were dividing us up, trying to conquer us. It was ridiculous. So here, one day I went to talk to a friend of mine who was working on my rig, and he said, "You've aligned yourself with the wrong people. You're with them Bundys and them crazy people who won't even pay their grazing fees and blah, 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 blah." And I said, "Wait a minute, I haven't aligned myself with anybody, but I'm out there trying to figure out what's true and what's not." He said, "Well, some of your cohorts were over here at the armory this morning. We had to call the cops on them." Really? And he got a phone call right then. He really got bowed up. He pulls me in the chest. He says, "They're over there now. You better go find out where your cohorts are up to." And I said, "I haven't got any cohorts, and I'm absolutely not afraid of anything on this planet, so I'm going to go see, and I'll come back." Well, the vehicles left. I followed one of them until they stopped. I got out. I said, "My name's Chris Bryles. You were just over at the armory, and it's really upsetting some of the people here. We got a lot of weird things going on, and I'm trying to alleviate some of my friends' fears. Can you tell me who you are?" "Well, I'm Bill, and that's Joe, you know. My name's Chris Bryles. What's your last name?" "Well, Bill and Joe." "Okay, and why are you at the armory?" "We're not at the armory." "Yes, you were. I just followed you from there." "Well, you got no business to follow us. What were you there for?" "We're just two guys going through town trying to start a new business." "Well, typically we don't have a new business at the armory." "Yeah." "So why are you here?" And then the littler one, he says, "Well, actually we were at the armory, and we were looking at the deer in the backyard there, and there was a big old 4-point shooter in there. Boy, that's a nice buck." And I said, "Well, typically we don't shoot deer at the armory." "Now, if you guys are sportsmen, one of them had camo on, I can show you where to hunt rabbits. We got some fishing, we got some sage rats, we got some things going on. But I'd really like for you to be honest. I don't think you're being honest with me." And the big one, he looks down at me, he's gonna intimidate me. That don't work. I said, "Just tell me the truth." He said, we're hungry. We're gonna go get a sandwich, if that's all right with you." I said, "Okay, I'll buy your sandwich if you're just honest with me, please. This is important." "No, we're just gonna go eat if that's all right with you." I said, "Okay." So they left, and I took a picture of their license plate and their vehicle, and I went up to the sheriff's office. I've been in and out of that sheriff's office, I don't know how many times, gobs of times. I was met with an automatic weapon.
"Oh my gosh.
Where do you think you're going?" "I'm gonna go talk to the sheriff." "No, you're not." "Why?" I said, "Tell him my name's Chris Bryles, and I wanna talk to him. He's in a meeting." I said, "Well, call him and tell him that I need to talk to him. It's important." He said, "If you have a problem, you call 911. I said, "There are some dishonest people doing some weird things in this town, and I want to talk to the sheriff." And here this automatic weapon came up against me, and he says, "No, like I said, call 911. I said, "Well, thanks a lot for absolutely nothing." And I went back over to my rig, and I called the dispatch, and I said, "Hey, here's the license plate number. There's something strange going on here, and I'm being treated like dirt." And she's, "Well, Chris, I'm sorry, you're not dirt." And it's crazy. And I said, "Okay, this is the number. So then I drove back down to tell my friend what I had found out. And there was a sheriff deputy down there and a Burns police chief. And they said, what's going on? And I told him what had happened. And he said, I don't know what's going on. Then the sheriff deputy got a phone call. And he said, oh, the two white vehicles were FBI, and the black one that you followed was FBI. It's a rental out of Washington State, and that's FBI undercover. And we have to keep that a secret. Don't tell anyone.
Really?
And that didn't really feel right to me. Well, that night happened to be the first night that Grassley had his little peacock session in his county court meeting at the high school. And the first thing he did, he gets out there with his microphone, he's parading back and forth. I want you people to know that the Harney County Committee of Safety has nothing to do with Harney County. They've got a website, and they've got our logo on one of their pictures, and they don't even have permission for it, and they are not in any way, shape, or form affiliated with Harney County. And so he pretty much demonized us right off the bat. Well, when the microphone came around, they said, take it, Chris, and then everybody knows I'm mouth off. And so I took it and I said, I want everybody to know that the Harney County Committee of Safety is not and has not been affiliated with Harney County, nor would we even want to be. And the picture of the county's logo has been taken off for any of those that have watched it. Ammon Bundy bought the website for us out of his own pocket, paid for our emails, special emails, and we have it, and we're controlling it. And I told them, we've been blackballed in this community. We can't have a meeting anywhere. But we did have one meeting. We had like 300 people there. There wasn't a single law enforcement officer there, and we didn't have any problems. Now, at this county court peacock show, there must have been 50 of them. They were all over the place. And I stood right there with a microphone in my hand, and I said, where do you think the fear is coming from? It's not coming from the refuge. Where do you think the fear is coming from? It's coming here. This is where the fear is. Well, they didn't like hearing that too much.
1 minute, Chris.
Okay. I told you there's no way I can handle it all.
There's no way.
Anything I should hit high on, Ryan?
1 minute ain't much time, but...
Well, we're not... This isn't part of my minute. We're talking.
Just mention, what the current member's name, the old man, said about this being the jewel of the county.
Right. Jerry Miller said, and I should have, when I moved there in 1978, Harney County had about the largest per capita growth rate. It was one of the wealthiest counties. And now it's either the last or the second to the last. The unemployment rate has been the highest in the state. It made it easy for me to write grants. But our economy is down. As the Forest Service put more and more pressure, and the people made it less logging, then there were more and more Forest Service people. Less loggers' jobs. They shut the mill down, one of the largest mills in the United States in the early 30s. In the early 30s, it had the longest building undercover in the world. And now it's a ghost town. And what I would like to say is that we are in the United States of America, and we have allowed this to happen in our country. And we have to stand up, and we have to fight. I was asked if I would come and talk. I live in Burns, Oregon. I drove down here because they said somebody wants to hear from somebody that was actually there. I had a brother in Denver. He didn't believe anything that was going on until I told him. And he says, you've got to be kidding me. Yeah, don't listen to mainstream media.
No.
It's pretty sad. But we all need to be together. You know, they divide and conquer. They take the Bible. They take your guns. They take your friends. They take your relatives. Everybody's all split up. Now you got all these little people that don't have any leadership or don't know which way they're going. They're easy to handle. We need more people that aren't easy to handle. What they did to these people with water is crazy. Crazy, crazy, crazy. What do you think would happen if all of a sudden 10 lowboys with 10 bulldozers showed up and put it back the way it's supposed to be?
Here, here!
Anyway, I ate up my minute, didn't I?
I could listen to you all night, but we're limited on this.
Well, sit down.